So I'm sharing with you what I find through the scriptures and by the Spirit, what it is to be a real person, a completed person. And I wouldn't share if it wasn't what I'm, by the grace of God, know myself. And knowing is inside you, because we're spirits. Jesus said God's a spirit. Spirit's the person, therefore the person in the is a spirit. A spirit, a knower, a lover, and a chooser. That's all we are. And he fathered our spirits. He created our souls and bodies. Our souls are a means of expressing ourselves, and our bodies express ourselves. We are spirit. He's spirit, we're spirit. That's why you, that's why you have united with him. Like father, like son. Things aren't spirits. We are. Spirits are knower. Paul said, what man knows the things of man, except the spirit of man is in him. So knower, you, knower is you. I know. That's you. You operate because you know. You're comfortable in this room because you're in the room. You live by knowing and you live by desiring. Love, all life, of course, it teems with desire from the atomic power upwards. Everything's a mass of desire, which is love. It depends what way the way love goes. We want to satisfy others, love. So a person comprised of knowing and loving and then choosing. Choosing is what we nowadays call faith, or the Bible calls faith, putting yourself into something. Faith isn't theorizing about something, it's committing yourself to something. Now that's how you came here tonight, or this afternoon. You knew you could come. You desired to come. You may be a little regretful a little later on, but at least you started desiring to come. So you know you could come. You could have, I'll come. That's a person. And your car or your feet only brought the I come here. The I come's you. The I am is you. Now it's expressed through your emotions, that's your soul. Expressed through your reason, your rational faculty, that's your soul. Expressed through your body. But you are the knower, the desirer, and the chooser, which puts us in something, which is the faith. That's all you are. That's all God is. That's all man is. And that's how we operate. And therefore, to be a person is to know who I am, and then function as who I am. Now, of course, what the Bible teaches us, a real I am, is a union of the I am and my I am. Oh, it's a union. The Bible says he, as he's joined to the Lord, is one spirit. One, not two. That's in 1 Corinthians 6:17. It's your spirit. Get spirit isn't a kind of spook, it's a person. Because he's a spirit. Jesus said God is spirit. So the person in the universe, all this is product of the person, isn't it? It must, in the beginning, he, it's all come out from him. It's manifestations of him in variety of forms. You can't see him in a thing. You can see a form of him in a thing. Everything is marvelous. You can see him in a person. That's why he has persons. He can reproduce himself in persons, because he's a person. So we're spirits as he is. Everything expresses him, manifests his glory, and you can see him. I see through everything. I see his wonder, glory, beauty, everything. But that's not he. But persons is a form of him. And the Bible says he, we humans, sinners saved by grace, joined to God, what's it? So a real person is a person who's a person. He's really God as a person. And he knows he isn't really he. He's really the living God, and he's expressing the living God. He's the real person in him, is the living God, and he's expressing the living God. That's big talk. That's what the Bible says. So I'm talking about how to find out who we are. I find out who we are through the book, but the book must be interpreted by the Spirit. The book's no good outside you. It's got to come inside you. Oh, that's what I know. It's got to come out. That's why Jesus said, the words I speak unto you, they're spirit. Spirit's inside you. So they dissolve from being the book and become you. Oh, that's it. That's I. Now, I take it. I'm speaking to those who've begun that relationship. I can't say to the audience this size, but I must take it you're born again. That's a fundamental matter. And if you're born again, it means you knew you were wrong. That was a very great thing. You were not a right person, you were a wrong person. And the Spirit of God operated on you through the law and through the gospel until you say, I'm a wrong person. So wrong, I'm under a curse, I'm under condemnation, I'm going to hell, I'm lost. And that made you mercifully dissatisfied with yourself. And was there a way out? Could you be back to God? Could you get right with God? Could you go to heaven instead of hell? Could you be forgiven? Could you have eternal life? And so on. You became dissatisfied with yourself, and you found outside you, in a book, certain things were said. You can't buy an outside book. It's got to come inside you. And the outside book told you about God loved like this, and he loved so much his own person, his own son. He came and himself took upon what him, what you come to us, took our sins on him, went to death, went to hell on our behalf, where we should go, and rose from the rose again to wipe out that condemnation and that guilt and that wrath and that destiny in hell. That's outside you. But because you've become dissatisfied enough, if you've been born again, you've been a dissatisfied person before you're a satisfied person. Dissatisfied with the old life where you tried to be satisfied. And you're dissatisfied, could I be satisfied? I want peace, I want forgiveness, I want to get rid of those wrong things in my life. I want power, I want God, I want heaven, I want hope, and so on. You want, I want. You can't live by wanting, you live by having. I'm not a wanter, I'm a haver, I'm an iser. Life isn't getting, it's a being. It isn't a getting, it's a being. When you're a getter, you haven't got there yet. When you're a beer, you have got there, an iser. Now you were a wanter then, but I hope you're not on that level, not a wanter now. But what happened was this, because you're a free person. Now, this is a great thing. God's free. He only re-expresses by freedom. You see, persons that re-express God. People to see the living God through persons. Therefore you must be free, because a person's free. In our freedom we make our choices. And therefore, if you're born again, there came a moment when, knowing first by the witness of God your disillusioned condition, not condition, hearing about this, you can't think about what you hear, it's got to be inside you, hearing about it and being attracted by it, God loved like that, and it says Jesus died like that, and it says he rose again and is alive now, and that all this past is wiped out, and you enter the family of God and have eternal life, and God becomes your father, and Jesus should say, you hear that, now you're a free person. You chose. Choose means, you said, all right, Lord, what it means, I take that as fact. It's the obedience of faith. See, obedience isn't doing a lot of things. Obedience isn't praying more, reading more, it's believing more. The Bible word is the word Paul used in the first chapter of Romans, and the last chapter of Romans, actually, is a great letter. First chapter says, unto the obedience of faith. The last chapter, last verse, almost, said the obedience of faith. What obey, what's faith? Believe what God says. Believe, prayer comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Believe what God says. How do you believe? All right, you're an inside person. That believing is your will. All right, I'll do it. You don't do anything. But inside say, okay, I'll believe that. I know what it means, but he says that he died, that he's arisen, he's alive, I can't see him, but I take a bigger leap, I'm going to believe him, I believe he did die, did rise, I'm going to accept him and believe, and he becomes my saviour, and I believe him, my sins have been washed out, and I shall find I'm a child of God, in the family of God, and so on. And if you're born again, you did that. Then you had the first experience of the true product of faith. See, everything's done by faith, because faith is choice. But on earth, you fulfill your own choices. The Bible word on faith is faith is the substance of things hoped for. That's Hebrews 11:1. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. A thing hoped for isn't substantial to you. It's insubstantial. Where is it? I hope for it. Faith makes it fact to you. Faith makes a hopeful thing a fact to you. Faith gives substance. Now you always do that. I couldn't prove this chair would hold me till I put faith. I had to commit myself to it. Looking at it didn't move prove it to me. I said, what's happened? It holds me. Faith comes. I'm not holding up the chair. It's holding up me. So you put your faith in something. It comes back and says it's real to you. Humanly, you do it with your hands. Here's food, all right. You say, that's good food, I desire it, I'll take it. Now, humanly, you take it. Then it takes you. The taker took it, and you have to have the alka-seltzer, whatever necessary, put things right inside. See, faith always is the thing you take, takes you. And in on earth, you probably do it with your car. You take coming here, and here you are. You take food, where your food, here it is, takes here. So it's all faith is operating. Moving into something available, because it's there and you desire it, as you move into it, it becomes a fact to you. Now, if you're born again, you moved into the real substance of the faith, which is you took a person you can't see. On the basis of God's word, a person risen again, you see what happened? You received you. If you're born again, the Spirit came back to you and says, yes, he is your Savior. God is your Father. You are forgiven. And that's come into your peace. Well, I don't know how, but Jesus is my Savior. God is my Father. I'm a member of his family. And what is still more wonderful, really, is you couldn't help but gain love. The Bible says when you're born again, just Romans 5, when you have peace with God, peace is selfish in a way. Oh, that fear is gone, those sins are gone, that judgment and hell is gone. I've got peace with God. That's wonderful. But that's just a personal matter. But then the Bible goes on to say, when the Spirit of God makes it real to you that Jesus is your Savior, the love of God is shed abroad in your hearts. That's Romans 5:5. By the Holy Ghost, not your love. Love of God is given you by the Holy Ghost. Love of God shed abroad your heart by the Holy Ghost who given unto you. And you begin to love. Now that's when you really begin to be a new person. You've begun to be an expression of God. See, God is love. And when you're born again, you think you love him. When I first, at 18 years of age, took Jesus, he'd been no interest in me before. I was more interested in football than Jesus Christ. He said, I saw as a lost sinner. And then I went to him as a lost sinner. Oh, that's why he died for me. I fell in love. Oh, he shed his blood to save me from hell. I fell in love. That wasn't my love. Really, it's his Spirit of love began to live in me. That God began to live my life, you see. I didn't know it then. The Spirit of God, whose Spirit is God, love, began to operate in me and express his other love. That's the first time I love somebody else more than myself. If you're born again, you begin to love somebody else more than yourself. That is Jesus Christ and Father and other people. This is a new birth. So I'm talking to you that you are taking, you already have a member of the Spirit family. And Spirit is more real to you than matter. You now say, oh, this is just passing stuff. It's temporal. It's just made of a bunch of atoms that run about and disappear again. There's nothing much to it. Things are not seen eternal. I'm talking to you, I'm taking you, the eternal is the living God, the living Son, the living Spirit, and you. And you're part of a living person. And these things are just fiddling little things came out from him. That's why you've got faith, you get more. If you've got faith in him, you get a broken chair, you get a new chair. Because you take from the universe. He's the universal person, he's an invisible person, part of the Son of Spirit. You're part of him now. You've been made a member of his family. So Spirit and Jesus and God, a Father, are more real to you than these things. You've been to operate faith on this level. And the first step of faith you took was that one, when you'd use your faith to get your food and get your chair and get so-and-so and get things and then got yourself. This time in your need, you couldn't get Jesus Christ. He was out to you. By faith you said, I'll take you. And then the Spirit came back. And in fact, he said, yes, he's taken you. Yes, he has got, he is your Savior. You do belong, you are saved in him. You have the Heavenly Father and so on. I'm talking to you as such. Now I'm talking about those, you have got that. Yet you can't say you're totally satisfied. You can't say you can handle all life. See, this life is not being handled by life, it's handling life. You're not life on top of you, you're on top of it. This life isn't sinking in the waters, it's walking on the waters. This life is gaiety and complete. When you've got what you want, your life's fun to me. I live by fun. If I didn't find fun in Christianity, I'd try atheism instead. I like fun. Fun's, oh, that's it. So life isn't, it's, oh, that's it. Now, I'm sort of saying to you, you probably wouldn't be here, thank you for born again. Maybe you are, you can't say you're wholly satisfied. You can't say you've got all the victory you ought to have, all the peace, all the full meaning of life you ought to have. There's something that isn't quite in focus yet. Now that's what I'm talking about these days. Now, as we go on, you'll find the reason is, if you have a relationship outside Christ, and you haven't yet had it replaced by a relationship to an inside Christ. See, when you're saved, you're a lost person, hear your sins. Well, you read about Jesus Christ. There he was, he died, he rose again, you see him up there with the Father in heaven and the Holy Spirit, and you're related to an outside Christ. Well, he's your Savior. Hopefully, more than he's your Lord, your Father, but it's this kind of relationship. You don't live by this kind of relationship, you live by this kind of relationship. You live by being, not by coming. You don't live by keeping getting something. You live by something that's got you and you live it. It's you. You live by being yourself. It's the same principle as how you get a profession. You work at the profession to get you. You don't operate your profession by getting it, do you? If you're a nurse, or a teacher, or a doctor, or a cook, you decide, got you, I know my medicine. I know my carpentry. I know my cooking. I know my teaching. Somebody's got you. Now, oh, that's fine. I like to do my carpentry. I know my stuff. You operate your stuff. Oh, I like to cook. I know my cooking. Your poor husband may be, but I hope you do anyhow. You know, you're going, oh, I like to do medicine. Because somebody's got you, it's part of you, and you operate it. That's what humans are. That's something that gets you, operates you. Now, I got that language. Well, I remember the struggle I had when I first said Bengala language. Oh, a lot of sounds. I shall never get it. You know, kind of gibberish. But I must get it. Faith must get it, because I had to get the people, but I had to know the language to get to them. I remember the day, not so long, it wasn't a difficult language. Maybe for some month, I began to talk, and it got me. Now, that's years ago. I can waste your time talking the language. Now it's part of me. Now, which is it, the language or me? The language has got me inside, and I can talk Bengala. I talk it, which is it, I or the language? You see, all life is being caught up by something, and you operate it. See, that's what it is. Now, the real truth of being a person is you're caught up by God, and God lives in you, and you operate it. And you're expressing God, you're expressing His nature, expressing His love, expressing Himself, and you have an inner consciousness. I'm not I, I'm Christ, in me, operating by me. Like, I'm not, that language is part of me, I speak it, it's inside me, I operate the language. You've got your oppression, you've got carpentry, I operate carpentry. You've got cooking, I operate cooking. Which is it, you or the cooking? Which is it, you see? So humans are made, so we're managing and expressing something which isn't, it is us, but it's not us. And faith is the thing by which this thing gets you, a profession gets you. Now we're talking about the profession, of course, that we humans are made, that the living, the person in the universe, the person who's all of all the wisdom, all the power, all the, it's really you and you know him. And he lives in you, and you live, and it isn't really you living, and you speak, it isn't really you speaking. It's really he, and yet it's you. And you, of course, when you've got him, you've got the whole lot. If you've got him, you've got all the power, you've got all the wisdom, you've got all the peace, you've got all the necessary for life. You're complete. Complete in him. But to be complete in him is because he's complete in you. And then you express it. Now that's what we're talking about. I saw it in Paul's great word in Colossians. Well, I found he had two ministries. It struck me as a young man. If you read Colossians, he says, I have a ministry first to take the gospel to the world. Now, like through the scriptures, that's where I spent my life doing that. Take the gospel to the world. Take the saving Lord Jesus Christ to the world who's come to us. Now, he said, I do that. Then he went on. He says, but I have a second ministry. He said, that is to fulfill the word of God, to fulfill it. It's as if you give part of it in the gospel, now to fulfill it. So you read it. He says, my first ministry is I take the gospel of the world. Then I have a second ministry. He says, it's costly, it's me to do it. To the church, which is his body, he says. And that's it, to fulfill the word of God. As if part of it was the gospel. Now this is the fullness. And then he said, what is the fullness? He says, the fullness is in one simple term, Christ in you, the hope of glory. See, if you have a total Christ in you, there's not much room for anything else left. Christ in you, there's not much you left, because he's pretty big. Christ in you, Christ in, not Christ for you, Christ in you. And Paul said, this is a hidden mystery. He said, the riches of the glory, riches, because of course it's everything, you've got Christ, you've got everything. The glory, you can't have more than the perfect God living in you and expressing himself by you, you being the means by which other people can find him as you found him. You can't have more than that. It's the riches of the glory of this mystery, just Christ in you. And he went on to say, in that scripture, warning every man, teaching men, every man, that he may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. So this is completion. Perfection is completion. I'm here to present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Now, I saw that years ago. At that time, you see, it wasn't real to me. That's why I had to find that. I knew Christ for me. I knew Christ as my Lord. But to say he lived permanently in me, in the real way, what lives in you is really what you are, like your profession lives in you, it's what you really are. Now, if he lives in me, then what I really am is he. I'm just a means by which this person is operating. I didn't know that. I didn't know the quality in you in that sense. I went to Africa, and I was taking Jesus Christ to the Africans, as I told you. Now, I knew about taking Jesus Christ to the Africans, but then I found a scripture, another scripture, which got me, started me on this pursuit, as you might say. But of course, when you pursue the things of God, you find them. It isn't pursuing and not finding, it's pursuing and finding. It really finds you, of course. What I found in the scripture in Galatians 4:19, where Paul spoke about converts, my little children, from my travail in birth again until Christ before, until that travail in birth to Christ be formed in you. Oh, I said, that's different. It's as if he lived kind of, was talking kind of baby, embryo language, birth language, travail in birth. It's as if an embryo Christ became a fully formed Christ in you. Oh, I said, that's different. If Christ is a fully formed Christ person, I say, that's not much different to that person except as a means of expressing Christ. I don't know that, I said. I said, I'm not even bringing that to Africans. I'm bringing Christ to the Africans, hoping they may get a thing called eternal life. But this is making a new kind of person. See, I found the whole purpose of God isn't to give us a thing called eternal life, it's that we should be expressing eternal life, which is himself, and he's be re-expressing his eternal quality of life by us. I didn't understand that at that time, formed in me. Especially Mr. Bobby didn't understand that. I noticed it too. We had a leader at that time, a man who founded our mission, a great soldier of Jesus called C.C. Studd. He had this free way of saying things. We were very few in those days, only 8 or 10 of us, and had this huge Tory forest, about 1,000 miles of it. And then there were villages all around the forest. We'd go out in the villages, meet them, then we'd come together, of course, and have fellowship and pray together. And when we were together, he had a way of saying things sometimes. And one thing we would say was this. He says, Lord, I'm out here to see Jesus Christ running about inside black bodies. Well, I said, that's one way of putting it. See, not Jesus Christ coming running about in, that's the same thing. If Jesus Christ running about in you, then that's all there is. Your black body, your white body, showing him running about in you, that's all. Say, my dear. Now, I had to get some things through the scripture into me in focus to get this in focus. The first consequence was, like me, I didn't feel I had all I wanted to. Now, I'm talking to you like that. If you feel what you've got, if you've got all you want, I'm saying, all right, God bless you. You better go to sleep. You've got everything here this afternoon. If you don't feel you've got all you want to, then I'm talking, if you feel you're forgiven, accepted, loved, you've got all you want with power, peace, fixing, peace, and satisfaction, so that all the bells ring. Joy unspeakable and peace apart. You can't say, no, that, then I can talk to you, because I was like that. So there I was in Africa, but I felt I needed to be made better. I felt I needed a much greater quality of love to identify myself with these simple Africans in their villages. I felt I needed power, something could happen when I took Jesus to them. It wasn't like bouncing a ball against the wall and bouncing back at you. I felt I needed faith that something could happen. They seemed so dark, because we're all dark, we know each other, but it seemed so dark. And then contentions with fellow missionaries and judgmentalism and negativism and question of temptation of the flesh. I was a common human. So I said, I'm not the adequate person I ought to be. I'm not the adequate representative of Jesus Christ I ought to be to people. I'm partial. I'm not quite satisfied. I have tensions and fears and difficulties. Now, how am I not handling? So I thought I needed more. Not that the Africans needed more, I needed more. So I set out on a search. I'm talking an inward person. I don't mean outer search. I mean, all we missionaries, of course, tired at early morning time with the time with God. We lived in bamboo mud huts like an African. And in the early morning, we have our time with God alone, where we read the Bible and pray and commit. That's what I talk about, time of search. Now, in those times, I'd say, God, give me more. Make me more loving. Make me more powerful. Make me more victorious. More released. Make me a better kind of person. Now, I didn't know that I was under a big illusion. I didn't understand semi-illusion then. I thought I could be improved. I find the human self can never be improved. Oh, I didn't know that one. I'll tell you why I knew that. I didn't know that then. I thought, he must improve me. I must love more, I must have more victory, I must have all this stuff. So, in my quiet time, of course, I'd be taking it to him. And then one day he startled me with a very simple word. As I say, the Bible comes out from the Bible, the Spirit makes it real to you, comes alive to you. And he took a very simple word from Scripture and made it alive to me. The word was, God is love. Well, we all know that, don't we? Three words, God is love. But when it's in the book, when the Spirit takes it, it makes it real. And what it meant to me is, oh, if God is love, he loves a person. It doesn't say God has love. I thought that was a power that God had and put in me, and here I'd be loving. suddenly says, God is love. And I say, love, universal love, universal, everything, atoms love each other, insects love each other, life's full of desire, whatever form it takes, maybe self or whatever form, love. He is love. So I said, love's a person. I said, he's a universal person. So I had to get a new concept of God, not just a person up there, he's both individual and universal. That's both there, but he loves everywhere. But it's a person. It's as if God said to me, love isn't a thing I give you, because love isn't a thing. I am that love. Wasn't my name always I am, Moses' days? I am, not I have. When I said, sitting in my hut anywhere, that's rather selfish of you. You got the lot and left none for me. You're the lot and poor me. What about poor me? I need some love too. You know the way you talk, just between yourselves, anywhere to God. I needed power. And I found another scripture came to me. In 1 Corinthians 1, now Christ is the power, not has it. Christ is the power. Power is a person. Well, power is very universal. Atomic power. Power is universal. Christ is the power. So power is a person. So I began to get a new fact that God's a universal person. Now it's very difficult to see, first of all, because we're so used to seeing, because we got separated through the fall, that God's up there. Well, he is up there. It says he's above all and through all and in you. That's one of the phrases used of God. He's above all and through all and in all. So I've got to begin to find a God who's spirit, who's not just a person sitting in the throne up there or out there. He's somehow God's got to strip him. He's a universe. He is, and you find him anywhere, everywhere. He's there. He's the love. He's the power. But you see, the problem back to me was, I thought I had the power. I must have the power. I must have the faith. I must have the victory. I must have it. And it seems if he stole the lot and left none for me. That was this gap. Of course, he was teaching me something about that. So there I was. I learned this. He's love. He's power. God is my peace. He doesn't have peace. God's my peace. God is, the Bible says, God is my exceeding joy. God's my joy. It's not a thing. God's the joy. God's the peace. And then I finally find the scripture which fits the whole lot together. The first scripture, in the beginning God, that's all there is then, in the beginning God, that's Genesis 1. And way at the end, when the end comes, and it says the last enemy has been destroyed is death, this is in 1 Corinthians 15, the thing finishes. What does it say? It says Jesus Christ the Son should render up the kingdom of the Father, that God may be all in all. Well, what more, if it's all he is in some. If he's all in all, he is all in all his forms. So actually that's true now, you see it. Everything's really a form of him, maybe a created outer form, or maybe a person who can express him. All in all, isn't that a statement? Not some in all. All in all, that is. And when you have eyes, the spiritual eyes, you see, the world can't see it, of course the world's got to be all messed up, but we can see it. So I got statements like that. Now I had to move on. I'm told I have an hour. You better signal through the darkness at me and let me know. I can't tell when the hour comes. Pardon? I'm half a step. I didn't get that. You can come and signal to me when I want to stop. Wherever you are, I can't see you. Thank you. Now I want to move on. From him, that self to this self. I'm a self. I'm a self. You're a self. I must be satisfied self. I must be a living self. It's any good he being a self. What about me as a self? So I began to get the concept of himself as a total self. Yeah, but what about me? What's that relationship between him and me? So he now turns his attention to me, and this is where I had to begin to learn a new thing. At that time, a little scripture came to him. Another scripture, Colossians 3 verse 11. It says, the scripture says to the believer, now Christ is all, not has, is all and in all. Christ is all and in all. Well, I began to get a little glimpse, Christ is all, power and love. I suddenly said, in all, oh, I see. It doesn't mean I, Norman Grubb, become something. It means I contain him in all. If he's in me, if he's in me, then all is in me. It isn't that, it hasn't become me. It means the all is he in me. And I'm a me containing him. Oh, I said, that's different. That isn't I becoming a better kind of this self becoming something. It's just self-contained. Somebody who is the whole thing. But of course, you only live by what you know is inside you. There must be an inner reality to me that the real person living here is not I, but Christ, and I'm just a means which he operates. You have to know a thing inside you. That's why I talk to you as you're born again. If you're born again, you know Jesus. That's why I've not anything to say to you to really this evening if you're not born again. What I say would be nonsense to you. If you have stepped in by faith, received him by faith, and faith brings substance, and he's come back and you have consciousness somehow Jesus is your Savior, and that love of God is in your heart, then I can talk to you. Because then you can get a little glimpse of what I mean. He can give me the all in me. Christ is all and in all. But now, what had to proceed from that? I had to have a new understanding of the human self, and that's our trouble. Your trouble isn't Christ, it's you. If you're born again, he isn't the trouble, but you're the trouble. It isn't how he fits with you, it's how you fit with him is the trouble, or don't fit. That's the trouble. So self's the problem. His self isn't the problem, because we are happy, at least by faith, see what he is. I'm a problem, because I'm so changeable, variable, and seem to feel so much about which is a failure, and defeat, and so on. I'm the problem. So this is, I had to be solved myself. Now do you want anybody to say to me? Find out who you are. All you are is a container. At that time, Christ is all and in all. And then the first illustration he gave me at that time from the Bible was where three times over the New Testament we're called vessels. Well, vessels are not an old-fashioned word for a pot or a cup. He says, all you are is the cup, you're not what you contain. Illustration can be a cup of coffee. Or if of course you're good British, you like tea, a cup of tea. But the point is, it isn't the cup is the means of containing the tea. The important thing isn't the cup. It isn't the character of the cup, it's the character of the liquid. What liquid does it make available to you? It's the means of which the liquid's available. All you are is the means of which God's available. You're a vessel. And I noticed this. The Bible said you could have an alternative liquid. Where it said left vessel, I saw Romans 9 says you can be a vessel that contains wrath. I think you say wrath, but you can't get you understand what I mean, wrath, I say. Vessel contains wrath, or a vessel contains mercy. Well, wrath is a part of Satan. Mercy is part of Jesus Christ. So either I'm a vessel that's containing the spirit, Satan's spirit, which produces wrath, or I'm a vessel containing Jesus Christ's spirit, Jesus' spirit, which contains mercy. I'm a vessel, but which is in the vessel? And do you know what I began to find? I began to find it all wrong. Humans never had a nature of their own. Humans never had a nature of their own. Humans are marvelously made, they're real cells, they're real capacities. We have all the quantity, like a computer, the mental capacity. Nature is your quantity. What kind of person you are, that's another matter. You've got all your capacity, your emotions, your desires, your appetites. Oh, wonder, we have God made us wonderfully made. Look what comes out of the brains of man, wonderfully made. Your nature isn't your faculties, your capacities, it's your quality. What kind of person is it? What kind of person is expressed by you? That's not us. I never knew that. See, I thought, this is why I began to get things wrong. I thought I ought to be made a more loving person. No, the quality isn't me. The quality is the God in me. I ought to be more powerful. The power isn't me. The capacities, but the power can express itself through me. But the power, person, power, quality is his. The peace is his. I began to find the Bible says humans never had a nature. I got the illustrations together. I found where the Bible says I've got vessel. Well, we all know John 15, if we're people of God. That's the vine branch chapter. I am the vine, I am the true vine. You are the branches. I know it's the true, that means it's a false one. But the point is, a branch isn't the nature, is it? It's not the nature of the branch. The branch is the agency of which the vine expresses its nature. It gets its fruit through. It's a branch is the means by which the vine reproduces itself. And there Jesus says, you can be one of two vines. You can either be a false vine, produce the wrong fruits, the Satan vine, or you can be Jesus Christ's vine, produce the right fruits. Then I found temples. In the old days, when God hadn't knew, we didn't know our body was a temple, he made temples like tabernacles. Now, the point wasn't the quantity of the tabernacle. It wasn't, is it a magnificent, our false pride can make a magnificent church building. That's the point. It's the quality of the deity expressed through the temple, which God showed in that temple. It's a temple of Satan. It's a temple of Christ. That's what matters. It isn't the nature of the temple. It's the nature of the person who was manifested and glorified in that temple. And then today the Bible says, oh, this is your temple. Which is in it? Are you a temple? Or temple of the Holy Spirit? Or which spirit are you? Are you a temple of the Spirit of Christ? Or temple of the Spirit of error, Satan? So one by one, I began to find a new thing to be. You're quite right. It isn't that humans have a nature. Humans don't change. Humans are a container, something like a computer. Now a computer has great capacities, but it only expresses its programmer. It's the stuff it expresses is its programmer stuff. And it can develop it, maybe. It isn't its stuff. It has to be programmed. It can only express what it's programmed. Now, that's what we argue. We like magnificent computers. They're great development. We're persons. Great development. Have a mind and a body itself. But actually, we express the nature of the God in us. And then I find that's, of course, what we're made to be. The simplest evidence that is there's been one perfect man who came as a man, Jesus Christ. He gave up his Godhead to become a man. He was son of man. He was number one man. He's our brother, elder brother. It's marvelous. He's the firstborn of many brethren, the Lord Jesus Christ. So in order to go through and win the battle, he had to be one of us and then take his sins take his sins upon us and bear our sins and so on. Now I find, what did Jesus Christ say as a man? Tremendous self. He said, I am the way, I am the light, I am the truth, I am the door. Look inside him. Oh, I don't do anything by myself. I only do what I see the Father do. And I don't express any views of my own. As I hear, I judge. Well, where is this person who is doing the Father's will? And then in the supper table, when the Spirit was going to come out of him back into us, he was going to die and rise and in Pentecost come back into us. He then said to the disciples, and he said, he's going. And they thought, the Father's up here somewhere. In my Father's had many mansions. So one of them said, Father, Jesus, you say you're going to the Father. Won't you show him to us where you go? You talk so much of your Father. You're leaving us like orphans. Can't you show him to us? Yes, he said, if you see me, you see the Father. He wasn't the Father, he's the Son. Common carpenter walking him out. He says, if you see me, you see the Father. He says, you see, a human expresses God. Now, I'm the human, I'm number one human, and Satan never got him, so Satan never got inside him. For 40 days, Satan tried to get inside him without temptation. Come my way. Get my self-spirit into you. Have your life run to self-ends. God, the self, gives himself to other people. I'm expression of a God, gives, not makes other people die for me. I die for them. That's me. So he said, I'm always, you see me, you see the Father. Do you see, therefore, when people see us, they see Christ. They see the Father, they see that's the Son. Our life is a common life when we know who we are. Actually, we're expressors of the deity expressed by through us. All right. But then I found this. I said all along, yes, but that's an alternative deity. There's an alternative God. Because I must be free. A person must be free. Communism shows us that. Bondage, whether put upon you, be free. We free. So therefore, as humans, we had to be free to make a choice. And the great choice a human can make, because it's a choice God made. Shall I be a self for myself? Self-loving, self-getting, self-gratifying self? Or shall I be a self for you? Shall I find satisfaction getting all I can for myself and to hell with you? Or shall I find my satisfaction getting everything for you and going to hell for you? Oh, which way? And I saw Jesus, God himself settled that. I found the scripture said of God, the original God, in the beginning, he cannot lie. Now a liar is an expression of self-getting self. A liar gets his own ends. Well, he says, God can't lie. What did it taught me? He showed me that number one person in the universe could have been a self for himself. Everything just for his own advantage and to hell with the rest of us. But there I saw what the Trinity is. I saw that number one person, instead of saying just for myself, I bring my son into being. I love my son. I'll be a lover. I'll start a love relationship, father-son. Now father-son will come the whole family later on. I'm going to be a lover person, not a self-getter. My self-love will be in self-giving, not my self-love in self-getting. So you see, every person has to, or a person like God, that has to be settled with you. Now you see, there's coming to be, right in eternity, somewhere in heaven, a false God, a person who was free, apparently the person most created near the throne of God, in those days called Lucifer. Lucifer meant he used to bear light, he used to bear showing God, self for others. No, he said, you read his story, no, I've got full of beauty, full of power, I'll be for myself, I'll run my own life, I'll be my own God. So he brought it to being a false kingdom, that's why he's God of it, a self-loving self. He's the God, the spirit of error, of self-loving self, self-getting self. Now do you see us in the Garden of Eden? We have to be free, we have to learn our freedom, so we're confronted by the alternatives, by the two trees. And we are told that if we take near the tree of life, it says, which means the fruit goes into you, you'd have eternal life. Boy, I read that, I said, I know it's only a symbol, because eternal life isn't a fruit, eternal life is Jesus Christ, as our brother already has said, Jesus Christ. So it symbolizes, if you take the right fruit, Jesus Christ comes into you, and he begins to live his quality of life by you. Therefore, if you take the wrong fruit, the spirit of self-centeredness gets into you. That's what happened. And we were tricked by Satan, and we received that fruit, we received into us this spirit of error. Satan came and dwelt in us, and began to express himself in us. Now, I've got to get this straight, because this is a difficult point. See, something happened then, which has made a vital difference to us. Until you get this difference clear, I had to get it cleared up. Until you get it cleared up, you won't get anything clear. The vital difference is, Satan himself is self-deceived. He thinks he runs himself. I'm independent. He's not. He's God's servant. Of course, he's made by God. God uses Satan. We'll talk about that tomorrow. God uses Satan and evil for good ends. He used Satan to crucify Jesus so we might get resurrection. So God uses the evil person for his own ends. He's God's agent. But Satan doesn't know that. I'm myself. I'm my own God. I run my own show. I'm independent. I'm self for self. Now, he is a deceiver. The Bible says, as one statement in Revelation 12, which gathers all the names of Satan together, it says, that old serpent called Satan and the devil, it's the only scripture where the three are put together, that old serpent, the God of Eden, called Satan and the devil. That's three. What did he do? He deceived the whole world, it says. Now, deceives means you're tricked. They say, kid you, makes you think what you are. Now he's deceived, he sees his independence. Now I want to say this, what he did in the Garden of Eden, he tricked, you didn't know he occupied you and expressed himself by you. He made you think it was yourself. You run your own life. A human never runs his own life. A human is a computer who has a programmer. He's a branch that has a vine. He's a vessel that has a liquid. And the running is the, what kind of liquid? What kind of vine? What kind of programmer? It's the God in you that runs his quality of life through you. Now Satan hid that. Satan made, you're the one who does it. You do the bad things, you do the good things. You never did. See, that's how we've been tricked. See, you and I never did good or evil. The evil was Satan expressing himself, getting self through you. The good is Jesus Christ expressing himself, getting self through you. Now we're free people. Because we're free, we cooperated. And that's what involved. We chose to be with Satan. So we are cooperating with him. We didn't do the sin. Satan did the sin. Now Jesus saw this. I want to try to explain the importance of it. It was when it's in chapter 8 of Gospel of John. When the Pharisees, nuns, unborn again people, were attacking him. That's like we were. We used to be self-righteous Pharisees. Attacking Jesus Christ, refusing him. He suddenly said, here, there are two fathers, not one. Well, we... two fathers, not one. He says, I do the things I see with my father, you do the things you see with your father. Well, these are indignant Jews. Jews are monotheists. What do you mean? They said, we weren't born of fornication. God's our father. He said, if God had been your father, you'd known the father of love, you'd known the son. Then he said, underline the scripture in John 8:44, you of your father the devil, the lusts of your father you will do. Now that's why I did my own lusts. No, I didn't know I had a deity, and he's a self-loving, self-getting, self-gratifying, self-for-self God in me. And he operated himself by me. So those lusts I have, he's putting his lust through my lust, my desiring faculty. He put his hate through my love faculty. He put his jealousy through my jealousy faculty. He takes my faculties, put his lust, his, they aren't my sins, they're his. Now I cooperated, so I'm stayed with him because I cooperated. But I'm going to cooperate with sin the same. Now, you see, I never had a nature. I expressed the nature of the spirit of error. I found that also from a scripture in 1 John 4, which speaks, I got it suddenly then. It suddenly says, on the Redeemer, greater is he in you. All right, you're saved. That's the Holy Spirit in you. But it says this, greater is he in you than he is in the world. Oh, I said, I didn't notice that before. There are two he's then. There's a he in the redeemed and a he in the unredeemed. And then two verses later on, John gives them their names. Says, hereby know the spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit in the redeemed, and the spirit of error is called the unredeemed. So you see, we've had in us the wrong deity, the wrong God, expressing his self-centered lust stuff through us. And we thought it was, he kidded us, makes you think it was us. It was us, it wasn't. We cooperated, so we involved in the sin, and where Satan goes, we go, but for the grace of God. But we're the cooperating, we were the real person doing it was Satan by us. And why is this important? Because, well, now you're saved. If you're saved, your sins are out. You know the sins you did, but you thought were your sins. They were sins, and you cooperated. They were sins. They were saying you were in hell. In the precious blood of Christ, they went out. And you're here at peace with God because he took your sin by himself and rose again, and all that's cleared. Took away your sins. But the point isn't the product, it's the producer. It isn't the sins, it's the sinner matter. It's the person doing it. Now your sins came out of a spirit of self-loving self. Every sin has come of self-loving self. Every sin angry, it's because self wants its own way. But it's Satan's self wanting its own way by us. We combine Satan's self. Now we didn't know that. Now what's the consequence? Here's our trouble. We come into Christian life, we think, I hear better. Why do I have jealousy? Why do I hate? Why do I lust? Why do I get angry? Why haven't I had more peace? Why had I more power? I. As if this should be changed. This has never went wrong. It was stolen property. It's God's beautiful property, misused it. There always was a beautiful property. Your appetite is always beautiful. No way. But it's Satan's self wanting his own way by us. We combine Satan's self. Now we didn't know that. Now what's the consequence? Here's our trouble. We come into Christian life, we think, I hear better. Why do I have jealousy? Why do I hate? Why do I lust? Why do I get angry? Why haven't I had more peace? Why had I more power? As if this should be changed. This has never went wrong. It was stolen property. It's God's beautiful property. Misused it. There always was a beautiful property. Your appetites were always beautiful. They were misused by Satan. And you thought it was you. He kidded you. He made it think it was you. And then you condemn yourself. There I am jealous again. There I am lusting again. What's wrong with me? And so we have this false teaching. If there are two natures, there are. There are no two human natures, there are two divine natures. Ephesians 2 says, when you walk in the old life, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the old fallen, the power of the air, the spirit was in you, there he is, Satan. In those days, according to the spirit that worked in children's disobedience, and whereby nature is children of wrath. You express the nature of your father, children of wrath. Now when you're saved, says Peter, we're partakers of divine nature, the divine nature, not us, that's Jesus' nature. We never had one. Now you didn't know that. Now you see, that's where we're tangled up. Why did I say, I must have more love? I thought I must be more loving. I must have more power. I must have more peace. I must be less judgmental. I must have less conquered by the lust of the flesh. I must be improved. I'm all wrong. I'm a beautiful. Only, see, when you don't know who you are, when you don't know that Jesus Christ has taken you over, and he lives in you, and Satan's out, Satan plays his games on you. Because you think you should be better, that self-effort is Satan. That tries you better is Satan. Self-effort is Satan. Satan is the God of independent self. And I wish I was so. That's Satan, because he's got you. Self-effort means you're in his hands and he expresses himself through you. And you can't get out of it. Now the person who learned that, I put it right, was Paul in a great chapter called Romans 7. It's a chapter, it's really where we're in an illusion. Romans 7 says this. Paul says, I'm a new man now. He said, I delight in the law of God, human man. Paul, the old law worker, he got saved. Here he was. I love God now. I want to please God, like when you prayed. I want to be like Jesus. I want to be right. I'd like no God. He says that. Now he says, what's wrong with me? He says, I found a commandment which bothered me. If an inside commandment, I shouldn't covet. Covet, you shouldn't have lust. You shouldn't have inner desires, wrong desires. He says, the commandment says, I shouldn't have wrong desires. I don't want them. I want Jesus. I'm full of them. Why do I have these wrong desires and lusts when I don't want them? I'm like two people. I'm like a new creature in Christ. All things, new things away. I've got the power of Christ operating. I know that. And yet here the other old things in me too. Why am I two? And then he saw it. Oh, he says, I see. That wasn't me. That's sin dwelling in me. A false invader got into the fall, called sin or Satan. Sin just came to in me. It's this person expressing his lust by me. Those covetousness I've got wasn't mine at all. He was using my appetites to express his desires. It was not me at all. Now he began to say, he says, he began to find his liberation. I don't go around condemning myself. It's I'm managed by the God in me. Which God? Which God? Which God? Now, this is the final great lesson Paul has. It's all I suppose I can say this afternoon. The final great lesson Paul learned and taught us. He said, I found there's more in the cross of Christ than I thought there was. I found there are two operations in the cross of Christ, not one. That's why we have in the Holy Communion the cup representing the shed blood and the bread representing the body, two, not one. Body and blood. Why? Because two things happened at Calvary by Christ's shed blood and by his crucified body. Now all of us here know the blood. We know because the shed blood meant he did die in our part, went to hell on our behalf, hell couldn't hold him, rose up again, so our road to hell is closed forever by the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ dying and rising on our behalf. That's out. That's taking our sins away. Now Paul says, watch that body. Get a little closer. He says, when you first come to Christ, you're here, you're a sinner. You see Christ up there, died for you. Praise God, praise God. You don't see yourself there. You say, he died for me, praise God, because he died, I haven't got to go to hell and so on. And you put your trust in that crucified Christ. Now Paul says, come nearer. It's in the fifth chapter of 2 Corinthians. He says, don't you know if he died for you, he represented you, that body was your body. That body represented all bodies. He represented you when he hung there. You were there. And so Paul said, don't you judge? If one died for all hung there dead. Now you hang there. Now Paul says, what's the point of your body? It's the agency for containing the spirit. The body, our appetites, faculties, express our self inside. Inside you, you've got a deity, a false deity. You've got the self of Satan operating by you inside you, in your fallen condition. You're expressing Satan. All those lusts and things were Satan expressing himself by you. So you really were an expressor of sin, expressor of Satan. Now he says, watch what that body on the cross, hanging there, and that was your body. And then he made this tremendous statement, it's the last verse of that chapter. It says, for God made his son to be sin for us, who knew the sin. Be sin, made him sin. How can you make Jesus Christ sin? Now, he bore our sins, that's not his sins. His blood, he bore our sins, imagine sins. He bore the penalty, imagine sins. Now, they were his sins. He's made sin. Then he bore our sins. That he died, that's wonderful. But he's made sin. How could you say that by sin? Because you express sin in Satan. Sin is the spirit. So Satan is the human body expresses the spirit in it. And the spirit, it's the sin and spirit you're expressing. So that body expressed sin. So in God's sight, this holy body, representing our body, expresses the spirit of error, which has expressed itself to us. Now what happens when the body dies? Out goes the spirit. When the body dies, out goes the spirit. And you don't bury a body. You bury a spirit, you bury a body. And so that precious body is buried, no spirit. Then Paul said in Romans 6, that's why I say he died to sin. He died for our sins, paid the penalty for our sins out there. Died to sin, but he died to be controlled by sin. Sin is the spirit, is the sin of Satan, say, is the quality of Satan, the spirit of self-endness. He died to this being, died, is out from him. When your body dies, out goes the spirit. That went out. And it said in the resurrection 2 years later, in came a new spirit. Now in that same body, our body, now has the spirit of Christ in him. No two spirits. No two natures. One nature. Out is the nature, Satan expressing his self-getting nature. Self-seeking nature by us. In comes the one who expresses his self-killing nature by us. And in the Trinity is made the manifestation of his own beloved Son, his Word. And then through the Word, cooperates the word, let there be, come the further ones, further sons, who also can operate their word. And he only means his manifestation. He has to re-manifest himself by person forms. And so when his own son, as we saw in the previous session, when his own son, in a sense, laid aside his deity and became son of man, and you very rarely would say son of God, but if he wanted to point the point, he's son of man, he's one of you. When challenged, of course he did say, in fact he died because he said he's son of God. But he loved to say son of man. And as son of man, he said, now this is what man is. How do I do mighty things? They said to him, you do mighty things. I do the thing. I do what I see my father do. I don't say a thing. I say what I hear my father say. What do you mean? Well, of course, externally, you couldn't understand. At that day, internal hadn't come, because the Spirit hadn't come. Of course, a few through history knew, but only after Pentecost did the Spirit come in a universal sense for those who receive Him. So he couldn't use spiritual terms too much. But right at the supper table where he's going to leave them, when he was going to rise and then come again in the Spirit, and that's the chapter where he said the Holy Spirit's going to come with you, then when he said, oh, he said, you got it all wrong. He said, you think the Father, as the sense in which he is up there, that's not the point. They said, sure, Father, if you see me, you see the Father, because the Son operates, he's really being operated. He functions, he's managed, he's really being managed. I appear to manage my life. I appear to say so-and-so. I am the Lamb. I am the way, I am the truth. But really, I'm expressing him. I'm just a means by which he expresses himself. If you see me, you see the Father. I don't do things by myself, I do what I see the Father doing. I don't speak words by myself, I speak what the Father says. So here's the pattern man. And therefore, if that's the pattern man, you can't be a satisfied man unless you're part of the pattern. And the pattern means, therefore, that you are as conscious as he is, you're not you. You're the living deity. John says he's God-worthy. Paul says Christ-worthy. And how do you see it? If we love one another, God is dwelling in us, and his love is perfect in us. So our loving is God-loving. Isn't that wrong? Don't look up there, find it. If you are loving one another, that is God dwelling in you, and his love is perfect in you. So see, humans are God re-expressed. God re-expressed. Strong, isn't it? Therefore, because that's what humans are made for, to contain deity. And remember, human is consciousness, humanity is consciousness, your flesh is beautiful as an agent. My soul, my reasons are beautiful, my emotions beautiful, my body activity is beautiful. That's how God comes out. They're my agencies. I am spirit within. He fathered my spirit. He created my soul and body. Father my spirit in Hebrew 12. He fathered my spirit, like his spirit. So, spirit is knowing. And when you know, you always live by knowing. You never did a thing which doesn't come from inside. Everything you ever did came because you know something, you desire it and choose it. I told you that last night. You came here this evening because you know you can come, you desire to come, aren't you? That's inside you. Outside you, your car, your feet bring you here, your body is here, but it's bringing you here, the real you is you. So, you is a knower. Paul makes that quite plain. He says, what man knows the things of a man, said the spirit of man which is in him. Even so, only the spirit of God knows the things of God. Spirit knower. So you're only competent where you know. I told you that this morning. Again, I keep perhaps repeating many things. That in your profession, you're competent when you know it. It may take you 5 years to be trained as this, or trained as that, or trained as the other. A time comes and it gets you. And you know it, now you live not by being trained. Oh, I know that. It's inside me now. I operate what I know. I operate what has got hold of me. I operate it. I teach my lesson, my subjects. I do my nursing. I do my engineering. I do whatever it is. So you live by knowing. And that's why a competent person is happy. He likes to do his stuff. He knows it. So knowing is, life is competent because it's a happy competence because you know a thing. Now we're in the new knowing. And the new knowing, of course, as I said before, I take you for granted, you'll say you're born again. Jesus said you're only born again if you see the kingdom. Except maybe born in the city, you can't see it. So it can't be these eyes. All we can see these kingdoms. It's, of course, the kingdom. So it means you come to a knowing. What you're knowing? By your faith, this time it's the juice of substance of spirit. The old faith produces by faith you take the food, the experience, or this and that. But by lifting the faith up to the spirit level, by faith in the risen Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes back and says, yes, yes, here he is. And he's your savior. So you know. So it's under the real person is the Lord Jesus Christ. The real person is the Heavenly Father. The real person is the Holy Spirit. And the company of heaven, half our dear ones have gone there already, and the angels, this is real. And you, this fades out and the other becomes real. And Paul says, well, we look not at the things yet seen, but at things that are not seen. Things are seen, when the fire stones are so intemperate, a bunch of atoms floating, shouting and rushing about, they change shape every now and then, that's all matter is, changing shape, that's all. Comes, you know, it doesn't matter. Things are seen intemperate. We're not seen. We belong to the things are seen, things not seen eternal, we're part of that. And my point is, you'll come at home and you know it. And you know it somehow, I don't know how you know it, a new one. Jesus is the Savior, I do know. And he's my Lord, he loves me, I love him, and God's my Father, and heaven's my home, and I've got the fortune of God. You're in the front of a new knowing, the confidence of a new knowing. You start your life by the fear of the Lord, you end it by the fun of the Lord, which must start with the fear of the Lord. You're enjoying the Lord. Now, as I say, it's difficult because it hasn't worked too well. It has worked, but there's so many, the past is out, your sins, the future is assured, your present is much more uncertain. And you aren't so consistent in the present as you were in the past and the future. But this life is to be equally consistent. And that's what we're talking about now. How we find this consistency equally. Now the consistency is when you know your knowing isn't a relationship, but a union. A relationship isn't a union. So you start in your, actually you read it today in those three levels. Little children, young men and fathers. We're talking today the young man stage when you come strong. Maybe tomorrow when we talk about prayer of faith and intercession, if we get so far, we'll be on the father stage. The young man stage is you come strong, the word of God abides in you. This is the union one. The babyhood one, you know the father outside. You trust like a baby, you trust that Jesus died for you, you trust your sins are gone. You don't know him inside. A little bit, because spirit really, but you don't enlarge way inside. It's more your relationship outside. Relationship isn't union. I know inside. Union is, well, yes, I am I, but I'm not really I. There's a bigger I inside me now. I am I, but that's a detail. I'm a little I, that's a big I, the living God. And I'm as God himself dwells in you. Isn't there something dwelling in permanence? Jesus Christ dwells in you, Jesus Christ. And the Spirit who makes the will dwells in you. We've got some permanent residence, haven't we? Oh dear. But that's no good, you don't know it. It's no good you say, I hope it is, or it might be today, it isn't tomorrow. And dwelling is permanency. Dwelling isn't visiting. Oh, that's a, whatever. If I'm in hell, that makes no difference. That's it. He's me now. The real he is the real me. I'm a me, but I'm a very minor me. Yet I operate, I'm a real person, I work, I do it. But all that I do, the real, that doing isn't the real person is the doer inside who causes me to do it. I've always liked that statement of Ezekiel's. When they say, isn't it dangerous just to walk free because God runs you? I said, Ezekiel, who knew a thing or two, said this. He said, I'll prop my spirit with you, I'll cause you to walk in my way. So I don't worry, I just had to walk it for me. He causes me to walk, so I find more fun. I don't try to walk, I can't help it for me. Wiggle and squeal and run away every now and then, but I still walk it. You're caused to walk it. It's because you're on the strong, and you were caused to walk for Satan, all right. You were very good self-loving self, I assure you. You were excellent, you were expert at self-loving self. Satan caused you to walk for self-loving self. You're pretty good at it, so was I. Now you're pretty good at the other one now. Don't say you're not. Be positive. Walking his word. But now, what I mean is, you walk by your familiarity. You practice carpentry because you know carpentry. You practice medicine because you know medicine. You practice cause because you know it. And you operate what you know. It's part of you. Now you practice Christ when you know it. Now you know him as a savior, to that extent you've got to practice it. You practice the sin is forgiven and he's your savior and you are a changed person, you're a new creature. But you never practice it fully because you've had this inner problem of what about my weaknesses and failures? And you haven't come to know that not only are you rated, you really, you're he. The real he in you is you. He's you're there, but the real he. That's how you know it. Now that's this new one. Now we spent our afternoon saying, to get that right, you've got to get your humanity out of its misconception. See, our humanity is simply the agency for God. It isn't a nature. Humanity is a magnificent capacity, something like a computer, only more so, magnificent capacities, mental, relational, psychological, magnificent. Look what produces the mind from the attitude of the man. But your nature is a quality. What type of person? What type is it for selfish? What's it for? Why do you do these things? Not what you do. Why do you do them? That's what you. And isn't you? And we deceive. I therefore told you how the Bible explains to us, and use all those symbols. That we're always a container. You're a vessel. A vessel isn't the coffee in it. You don't say what's the nature of the vessel. You say what's the nature of the liquid. Is it bad liquid or good liquid? Is it the vessel of wrath or the vessel of mercy? Is it bad liquid like wrath? Is it good liquid like mercy, Jesus? The vessel doesn't matter. You're a branch. It doesn't matter about the branch. It's which tree is coming through it. Is it a branch of the vine, expressing vine? Is it the true vine or the false vine? It's a temple. As I say, we proud people make too much of the temple. It doesn't matter what the building's like. It's who comes out of it. Is God met with there, or is it temple of Satan they have today? Which is it? So don't get it. It isn't this. This is as beautiful as an agency. It isn't it. It is a self. We're more than a temple. We're more than a branch. We're a person. That makes it difficult. We are, but even we operate.